Hello, my name is Hilton Hammond, and welcome to the second of the three-part series on ABCs of portable oscilloscopes. In this next section, we'll get into capturing and analyzing waveforms, answering that key question, how do I know if a waveform is good or bad? Capturing an unknown waveform can be as simple as a few steps. With the right scope, you can eliminate all the button pushing and knob twisting. With the Fluke ScopeMeter test tool, follow these few simple steps to get to a known starting point. Observe and follow all safety regulations. Know your test tool operation and its specifications. Then, firstly, start from a known good scope setup. We'll do that by resetting the scope according to the instructions in the user manual. Next, we'll connect the return lead to an appropriate reference point, after which connect the probe tip to the test point of interest. Next, we'll let the automatic connect and view capture, analyze, then set up the scope for a stable waveform display. Once you have a good starting point, you can fine-tune the setting to best capture or analyze specific parts of the waveform. To do this, start by fine-tuning the vertical, sensitivity, and position. Span the signal amplitude for a display of greater than 4 vertical divisions. Next, you'll adjust the time-based setting for optimum horizontal resolution or waveform display time span. For automatic measurements, make sure you have at least 3 periods visible on screen. This will make sure that the automatic measurements are performed correctly. For complex signals, sometimes you will have to adjust the trigger level or trigger mode. Start by increasing the trigger level to just above the waveform peak, going one step beyond the point you lose trigger. Then, slowly decrease the trigger level until a stable waveform display is obtained. Alternatively, shift the trigger level to a unique position on the waveform for a stable display. To become proficient in analyzing waveform traces, we must train our eye to always look in these four domains. First, amplitude or along the vertical axis. Second, time or along the horizontal axis. Third, we'll look for waveform shape issues. And then fourth, we'll look for any signs of disturbances that may be influencing the signal. We want to train the eye to scan up and down the vertical amplitude, then horizontally back and forth across the waveform time span. Then look for waveform shape patterns. Lastly, keep a lookout for any external disturbances. Before we get into analyzing waveforms, it must be said that diagnosing the root cause of waveforms is beyond the scope of this training. Every electrical or electronic system is unique, and each will present very different problems for you to diagnose. Having said that, with the right test tools and with the right troubleshooting techniques and skills, we can make the task that much easier. The best method is to put process in place to capture and document waveforms when the system is in good working order. Archive these tests, conditions, and waveform screen captures or measurements for future reference to compare against. Capture and document waveforms before and after a successful installation, repair, or even an upgrade. Documenting both the good and bad waveforms may provide clues to problems you may encounter sometime in the future. Or if you don't have that history, go to a system that is working and compare waveforms between the good and bad system, looking for any differences. Use the following waveform analysis techniques, tips, and tricks to spot potential areas of problems. Scanning the waveform's vertical axis can be broken into the following aspects. First, we want to measure critical signal amplitude characteristics. Use either built-in automatic measurements or cursors to measure characteristics at very specific points on the waveform. Next, we'll zoom out by increasing the scope time-based setting. Here we look for consistencies in amplitude of one period to the next or across multiple periods. Next, zoom in by decreasing the time-based setting. Look at the rising and falling edge transitions, specifically looking for any abnormalities. Increasing the time-based setting will increase the sample rate and therefore resolution, potentially uncovering hidden problems. Lastly, we'll watch for overall waveform trace for stability. Any vertical fluctuation may be an indicator of improper grounding or common mode signals influencing the overall waveform. Scanning the waveform's horizontal axis can be broken into the following aspects. First, again, we'll measure critical time characteristics using either the built-in automatic measurements or horizontal cursors. Increase the time base setting, again zooming out of the waveform looking for any inconsistencies in waveform periods from one period to the next. Difference in logic pulses could indicate logic circuit timing issues. Zoom back into the waveform by decreasing the time base setting. Look for any horizontal or time-related shift. Any sign of signal jitter or phasing could be an indicator of instability in a digital circuit's reference clock or logic components. Waveforms come in three distinct categories. Firstly, the standard wave shapes like sine, square, triangle, and others. Next, you get complex waveforms. Often these are from circuits where signals are summed together forming a complex control signal in a feedback loop, or from digital logic circuits adding or controlling logic circuits. Next are dynamic signals. These are those that dynamically change the key waveform characteristics in order to control some condition. For example, one signal is modulating the amplitude or frequency of another signal conveying information. Today's electric motors use variable pulse width modulation to precisely control electric motors and improve their energy efficiency. Next, we'll take a look at waveform characteristics to help diagnose potential problems. You can use key shape-related characteristics to look for problematic areas. These are typically waveform symmetry. Here, if you were to fold and cut the waveform along the center line vertically and horizontally, would the opposing quadrants appear exactly the same? Second are peaks and valleys. For sine and triangular shape waves, look at the positive and negative peaks to ensure there are no evidence of flat topping or other transition aberrations. With square or pulsed waveforms, check the high and low levels are flat and straight. Wave shape repetition. Here you'll want to increase the time base span to observe multiple periods are identical to each other. In terms of waveform transitions, inspect the transition points, making sure, in the case of triangular or sine waves, the transitions are clean, or with square or pulsed waveforms, the transition is a sharp 90-degree edge. For square or pulsed waveforms, ringing at the high or low transition points could be an indicator of reflections occurring in the signal transmission path as a result of impedance changes. Linear or logarithmic changes. Here you want to decrease the time base span to inspect the linear or logarithmic transition, either from a low voltage to a high or vice versa from a high voltage to a low. Use the display graticules to assess if the change in voltage level is proportionate to the change in time. Waveform disturbances are usually electrical phenomena that find their way into the circuit to influence the signal in one of the following ways. Noise is essentially induced electromagnetic interferences, usually from heavy-duty electrical machinery or interference from RF transmitting devices. Any length of electrical conductor can become an antenna that picks up radiating magnetic fields. For example, from devices like cell phones to high-voltage discharge lighting systems or even variable frequency motor drives. Transients or glitches can be induced by sudden changes in heavy-duty electrical loads, like that of heavy-duty electrical switch gears. These can be created by aged breakers turning on or off, or even a fan or pump starting up. Worst-case scenario is when a transient comes down the distribution system as a result of a lightning strike some distance away. Static discharge can build up in conveyor belts, pulleys, and other rotating machinery. Electrical conductors in close proximity to these rotating devices can become the lowest resistance path to earth ground, discharging any built-up energy through that circuit. Signal stability. Here you want to check for shifting vertical or horizontal axes. Any instability in ground references or DC offset changes could be an indicator of earth-ground loop problems. For any horizontal time-related signal jitter or erratic phase shifting, could be as a result of problems in digital circuit clocks and signal transmission pathways. This concludes Part B on analyzing waveforms. Next, we will review some techniques and functions to capture intermittent random events.